if I was here to tell you that you could have a carbon-free energy source that was easily manufacturable and widely distributed, enabling humanity to restore our climate? And what if I told you that there's a clean energy technology that could be the ultimate source of safe and reliable power? It would virtually provide unlimited energy, be radiationless, and be pollution-free. And what if I told you that we could do all of this with a little bit of metal and some hydrogen? And that this device could be the size of a microwave, something that could power your home, your car, and eventually your aircraft. And that this is also scalable. By stacking these together, we can have industrial size heat for chemical processing and steel processing. So we have targets to reduce global gas emissions by 50% by 2030. But the options we have, renewables and storage, are not scaling fast enough. Not to mention that we haven't even addressed land use change and industrial emissions. And so we believe that net zero is not enough. We need to go beyond net zero, and that we need new technologies to get there. And so what if there was a technology that could be a shortcut to our climate crises? All the fantastic things I talked about at the beginning are the potential attributes of cold fusion. What exactly is that? Some people call it low-energy nuclear reactions, LENR, and more recently, some people refer to it as solid-state fusion. Unlike experimental fusion that seeks to replicate the temperatures of the sun, cold fusion makes energy at room temperatures and pressures. And unlike nuclear power plants, cold fusion does not require radioactive elements like uranium, and Fukushima-style meltdowns would not be possible. So you may be surprised to hear why I'm interested in this topic. I live in Japan, and I have family there. As the only country that's experienced a nuclear attack and a nuclear disaster, many Japanese are still very apprehensive about anything related to nuclear. In March of 2011, Japan experienced a triple disaster, the Great East Japan Earthquake. It was an earthquake followed by a tsunami and a nuclear accident at the Fukushima Daiichi plant. Today, nuclear accounts for 6% of Japan's electricity mix. But the situation is precarious. Japan gets over 94% of its fuel from abroad, and recent geopolitical tensions have highlighted Japan's import of fossil fuels. Just in August, the Prime Minister announced that they would be returning the operations of all idled nuclear power plants. I believe this is a good solution, but we also need other options. And so in 1989, two professors from the University of Utah, Pons and Fleischmann, announced that they were able to achieve nuclear levels of output of excess heat from chemical reaction. The press called this cold fusion, and there was international attention for their work. But as universities around the world tried to replicate their results and were not successful, the two scientists were discredited, and cold fusion fell into the reputation trap. Students and researchers were discouraged from pursuing this topic any further. Nevertheless, in spite of the controversy, prominent scientists like Nobel Prize winner Julian Schwinger and Brian Josephson have advocated for a field and felt that it was too early to dismiss it. And so multiple groups around the world have been working on this topic, and over the years, they've reported similar phenomena of excess fusion. Although decisive evidence is still lacking, the momentum has been building. And so there are even research scientists here at MIT, along with others around the country, in the EU, in Japan, who have been pursuing this. In 2015, Google assembled a consortium of scientists from different universities, and they had a second look at the cold fusion phenomena. This was published in the journal Nature, and although they did not detect this particular phenomena, they were able to show that this research could overcome the reputation trap. And so this led to further research around the country, but at the same time, NASA has been actively involved. Under the title of Lattice Confinement Fusion, the space agency has been looking for alternative power sources to fuel long-distance space travel. Some people say that curiosity killed a cat, but as you can see, this cat is still very much alive. And more recently, the Department of Energy, through their ARPA-E program, announced a $10 million funding opportunity for low-energy nuclear reactions. And this complements some of the other work that's going on in the EU, where they're funding similar research. So these activities are now encouraging a new generation of young scientists to join the field and become curious about the phenomena of cold fusion. So you may ask, is $10 million too much or is it too low? I want to give you a little bit of context here. Over the last 2 years, private investors have put in $5 billion specifically for hot fusion. But this is dwarfed by what we're experiencing climate damages. It's estimated that we're now already experiencing $200 billion in hurricanes, wildfires, and flooding that's occurring around the world. But if we look at fossil fuel subsidies, the International Monetary Fund estimates that there's already over $500 billion of these subsidies per year. But if we also account for the ecological, health, and economic damages, then that balloons to nearly $6 trillion per year for fossil fuel subsidies. So I want to ask a question to everyone here. Would you take a job that could damage your reputation, make you shunned by your colleagues, and perhaps end your career? So that's a risk I took six years ago when I joined the Anthropocene Institute. I was told by some of my friends and colleagues that cold fusion was risky business and that I would be associating myself with fraudsters. But as you've seen, legitimate and high-quality work has been done. And so here I am. I'm now the chief scientist of the Anthropocene, and I'm proud to say that I have a very supportive group of scientists, engineers, communicators, and artists who work with me every day. And I've also been very fortunate to meet with researchers, policymakers, and investors around the world and helping them understand the maturity of these technologies. We advocate for all solutions that help overcome the climate and energy emergencies. And these include a wide variety of nuclear technologies that we understand, but also early innovations like cold fusion. And so history shows us that a lot of the innovations we see right now, from the car to the airplane to the internet, were thought to be impossible. And the people who led their introduction often had to battle naysayers. The same thing could be said of cold fusion. And as we've seen, several companies have now started to make forays into space. Although a commercial product is not in place right now, there's at least one Japanese enterprise funded by Mitsubishi who have announced that they will have a product ready by 2026. And although at this stage we do not know how much it will cost, we know that it will be safe, it will be radiationless, and there will be no waste to dispose of. And so perhaps cold fusion can one day be the power that enables us to power our cities, our factories, and maybe even our space stations. Thank you.